Everybody, my name's Jim. I'm an alcoholic.
Amen.
Well, I'm glad to be here tonight. I love this group. We get a lot done, too. Slowly. If you haven't been with us before, don't be too surprised how we take this book very seriously. And so if we're looking at it word by word by word, just bear with us a little while. You begin to see that this is the way we learn. My sobriety day is December 20th, 1964. I've been sober through the grace of God since that time. I'm an eternally grateful guy. I should report to you, I went to see my doctor today, and he said that I was disgustingly healthy. I was looking for some sympathy and didn't get it. Damn it, there just aren't excuses for crapped out behavior anymore. They've taken them all away. Oh, well, I can still claim senior moments, so you guys know that. I do it once in a while. By the way, you know that at one time I was a practicing lawyer in Beverly Hills, California, and I'm kind of a collector of lawyer jokes. And I heard one the other day I hadn't heard before. You ready? What do you call 50 skydiving lawyers? Skeet practice. About this one. The trouble with lawyer jokes is that lawyers don't think they're funny, and everybody else thinks they're not a joke. Bad, huh? Ooh. Okay, tonight we're going to start a wonderful chapter, chapter 3, beginning on page 30. Now then, right off the bat, we're going to be taking on one of the great myths around here. We're going to see what the big book has to say about a couple things, and especially, what's the big book tell us about the first step? Because the definition of the first step is right here in chapter 3. Now this chapter is extremely interesting from a number of different standpoints. The first part of the chapter devotes itself to an examination of the disease of alcoholism and putting the first step in context so that we can truly understand what it is that we're looking at with that first step. And the second part of this chapter really begins to segue into the second step. We'll see that as we move along. The second step, of course, talks about being restored to sanity. And there are a lot of people come in the door who look at that and kind of brush past it, being quite certain that there may be a lot of screwballs around the halls of AA, but certainly not one. They're not one of them. Pretty difficult unless we have been certified or been tied down in a rubber room or have been locked up somewhere or, of course, gotten off in a court case pleading insanity, but to consider ourselves as being insane. We know we drink too much or drug too much or both or whatever it is we do too much of. But this whole business of insanity, what's this mean to be restored to sanity? Well, the big book in the latter part of chapter 3 is going to show us, at least in part, what this insanity is all about. And therefore, paves the way for the second step. So let's begin now with the third chapter on page 30. The title being More About Alcoholism. Remember, it was either last week or the week before that we were studying what is a real alcoholic, and in the second chapter we were told that it was described for us graphically. Now we're going to be reading more about alcoholism. Let's start right at the top here and see what the big book is trying to tell us. Most of us have been unwilling to admit we were real alcoholics. Of course, that's why we call alcoholism a disease of denial, isn't it? That's exactly, in fact, this is the only deadly incurable disease known to man, which has a major part of its symptomology denies its own existence. That's a big part of the disease. And of course, it is a major reason why so many of us never make it. We got brothers and sisters out there right now that will never make it, haven't made it, never will make it. They're going to die of this stuff. And you and I are the blessed ones. You know, we're sitting here having been given the solution. We've been unwilling to admit we were real alcoholics. And you can kind of put a because in there, because no person likes to think he is bodily and mentally different from his fellows. Therefore, it's not surprising that our drinking careers have been characterized by countless vain attempts to prove we could drink like other people. We might have thought in many respects that we were trying to prove this to our drinking buddies or our friends or the doubting Thomases or the people in our families or in our churches or in our businesses that have been harping at us about our drinking. We'd like to be able to prove that sure, we can hold our liquor, and we can drink like normal people. Most of the time, it didn't work. Every once in a while, we might have been successful in stopping before we reached 15 drinks, and we were still on our feet and hadn't quite passed out yet. But for most of us, when we reached the advanced stage of alcoholism, we didn't stop until either we ran out of booze or we ran out of consciousness. And so these countless vain attempts, notice the word vain, it means absolutely what it says. We can't do it, but we kept on trying to do it. And one of the things that's happening here, of course, and maybe if you knew, you could identify yourself with this, because this is what most of us experience. Our brains continue to lie to us. They keep telling us, oh, it's okay, this time you're going to be just fine. This time you can do it. This time you can just go out there and you can have some fun. And after all, those people down at your local watering hole are expecting you, and they're waiting for you, and they're going to feel lonely if you don't come down. They're going to wonder where you are. And besides, there must be a lot of stuff going on down there that you need to get caught up on. And you're going to be just fine. Now, so what you do is, instead of having four drinks before you go to the bar, you only have two. And when you get down there, instead of ordering two doubles, you order one. And pretty soon your brain's saying to you, oh, aren't you doing so well? See, you're controlling this. You're going to be just fine. About the third round, give me about four more of them doubles. And then you say, how did this happen? I don't know. Well, I might as well get drunk now. Might as well, no point in stopping now. Can't fly on one wing, son. If you knew this and you identify with this, then so do all the rest of us. We've all been there. Countless vain attempts to prove we could drink like other people. The idea that somehow, someday, he will control and enjoy his drinking is the great obsession of every abnormal drinker. Now, why should that be? Well, of course, there comes a point, doesn't there, where we realize, even though we don't want to admit it, and most times we can't admit it, that we are clear out of control, that our drinking is ruling our lives. But somehow our brain keeps telling us, well, look, you're going to be okay now. Just try a little harder. Don't drink quite so much. Prove you can stay sober for 2 days, and that'll take care of the people who are mad at you. Just and all these lies that our brain keeps telling us, this is a form of insanity that we're not even aware of. Well, of course, the fact is we're goofy as hell. We really are insane, no doubt about it, and our brain isn't working right. We just don't know that. And so the great obsession of every abnormal drinker is that someday, somehow, I'm going to be able to control and enjoy my drinking. I want to get back to how great it was when I got started. Most of us can remember that first or second or third drink, that first, second, or third time that we had something to drink, and we can remember fondly the wonderful feeling of release. You know, there's a theory or something out there, people believe this, it's probably true, that the most exquisite feeling in the world is the release from pain. And fear is very painful. And what did alcohol do? It took away the fear and it took away the pain. And all of a sudden, we were different. All of a sudden, we were the best dancer on the floor. We were articulate, we were beautiful, we were handsome. We could forget about the pimples. I guess you call them acne these days. We just used to call them pimples. That used to be a game in junior high school. Let me pop your pimples. I know junior high school kids these days are far too sophisticated for that. And yet, with all of that, the alcohol took the wallflowers among us, the perpetual standards in the stag line from among us, and made us into party people, and we loved it. The fear was gone. And something with us, now a lot of people could accept that as being just a wonderful thing, but not become obsessed with it, but not us. That became what we wanted to recapture that feeling, and we began to do it as often as possible. And so now that alcohol has us by the throat, standing on us, jumping up and down and beating the hell out of us, our great obsession is that we can somehow get back to how good it was before. And you know, you're going to find that around here too, and a lot of times people in sobriety are having a lot of trouble because they're still romanticizing that first drink, romanticizing how great it was to feel that way, to feel sort of immortal maybe, or 10 feet tall, bulletproof, and just wonderful about ourselves, and a feeling we'd never had before, and about the only time we ever have it is when we drank. And now that we're sober, sometimes that comes flooding back in, you know, and we want to get that back. And we've learned, or we think we've learned, that that ain't going to happen. And yet, that memory, it may be the one strong memory of our drinking careers, is how good it was at first. The memory of the horrible times thereafter may have faded away. And so the big book tells us this, that the persistence of this illusion is astonishing. Many pursue it into the gates of insanity or death. And think about it. Here you can, it's like a dog chasing its tail. I want to get that back. My brain tells me I can get back. I'm going to keep trying. And now here I am. And the only person in the whole world that I can compare myself as being above them is the person sleeping in the gutter, because I'm sleeping on the curb. And this is how far down we've gotten, and our brain keeps right on telling us, you'll be able to stop, you'll be able to enjoy this again. Just find a way to do it. Many pursue it into the gates of insanity or death. Now then, this is one of the most important paragraphs in the whole big book. Here is a paragraph which kicks off everything. Here is the culmination of what we have been doing in reading the big book all the way through. By the way, for those of you who haven't been with us in the past, that's what this book tells us we're to do, to read the whole book, because it's written for us, and there's a whole bunch in the back of the book that we need to read and need to identify with. If we have read the book, if we have been getting to meetings every day, if we've been talking to people who are in recovery, that is the people who walk recovery, not just talk recovery, the people who, when you look at them, you know that they're solid in their recovery, been talking to them, letting them counsel you, but most importantly, praying. Even if you don't really believe there's a God out there, your sponsor is probably or should be teaching you to pray anyway. Remember, we learned when we first started out in the book together that the last word in Dr. Silkworth's opinion right in front of the book was pray. Because we're going to have to open up those gates. And all we have to do is open the door just a tiny little bit, and God comes flooding in. At first, we may only ask Him to help us stay sober and ask Him to give us the willingness to believe in Him. We may be praying to whom it may concern, or God, if you're there. But nevertheless, we begin to pray. And when we do, something's going to happen. This first step that we're going to read about in these four lines is not something which can be forced upon us, is not something which our sponsors can make us believe in. It's not something that we can talk ourselves into. It's going to have to happen. And it will happen. If we've been taking the action which will lead to this miracle which is going to come to us, this great gift that we're going to be given. Let's see what this gift is. What does we mean here? Remember that this book was written by people who have experienced the steps and then wrote the book. And so when we see the word we, it means we, each of us, did this. We learned. Oh, wait a minute, it doesn't say we made ourselves, we got talked into. We wrote the answers to 495 questions and it became very clear that, it says we learned. Now how do we learn anything? We learn because we have been willing to accept the truth. And the truth is contained in this book. And when we read this book, we learn about ourselves. We learn that we are alcoholics. Because we identify ourselves with the people in this book. We identify ourselves with these chapters which deal specifically with the disease. And so we learned. When you want to ask yourself, why do I have to read the book? You've got to learn. You've got to learn. We learned that we had to fully concede to our innermost selves that we were alcoholics. We learned this, that we had to fully concede, down deep inside, no more screwing around with this. This is not something that can be alleviated by my going to a meeting and saying, hey, my name is Jim and I'm an alcoholic. If I don't know what in the heck I'm talking about, it doesn't mean anything. All it means is I want to be part of the group. Or it may mean that I want to be able to go to so-called closed meetings, which are, I guess this is one I shouldn't say anything. Far be it for me to take on this whole group, no kidding. But we say it, and that for many of us, especially when we're new, we haven't got much of an idea what we're saying, but it's easy to say once you get past the initial shock. But here, it's a whole lot more than saying full concession to our innermost selves that we were alcoholics. This is the first step in recovery. And then you say, well, wait a second here. There's something missing. There's something missing here. What about my life being unmanageable? Everybody says that that's part of the first step, that if my life is not unmanageable by me, that I can't be an alcoholic? Balderdash. Think about it. If we accept as a fact, and I believe we must, that God is in charge of this world, when we say the Lord's Prayer together, we say, Thy will be done. We are not giving God permission. His will is going to be done whether we like it or not. Who's running this show? Who has all knowledge and all power? It certainly is not us. What do we have to do when we get to our third step? We have to quit playing God because it did not work. There is a God. It's not Jim. That's for sure. Billy knows that, but stop grunting over there, Billy, will you?
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, that's all right.
Just breathing heavy.
Yeah.
I get excited.
Billy's breathing heavy. He's excited, son.
Big book excited.
I suggest you girls stay away from him for a little while. Might not be too safe over there. We call that Billy's Corner. Stay out of it. The first step in recovery is the concession to our innermost selves that we are alcoholics. Here's the truth of it. Every single human being in this world has an unmanageable life. By definition. Because God is in charge. This does not mean, of course, that we cannot do for ourselves. Of course we can. It does not mean that we are unable to do those things which we can do. But the crunch time comes when we look at unmanageability as being unable to obtain our own wants, needs, desires, and our little plans and designs. If it doesn't work the way we want it to work, then our life is not manageable. That's baloney. Our manageability of our lives has to do with some very simple things. We can do each day what's in front of us to be done. We can do the very best job we can of those things which are in front of us to be done. We can refrain from hurting another person. We can do the next right thing as it presents itself to us. And we leave the results up to God. And then when we do that, everything changes in our lives. That's the way we live our lives. And we certainly are not powerless over taking right action. I know everybody here agrees with that. What we're powerless over, what is unmanageable by us, is the results. The moment that we start dictating the results and they don't come true and we have to go out and force things to happen, that's when we say, my life's unmanageable. Not so. It's always been that way. And everybody in this world has the same problem as we do. They just don't drink over it. Now, it may be a help to examine unmanageability from the standpoint of having some sort of an incentive to really, really try to get sober, really, really try to adopt a program of Alcoholics Anonymous. And if it has that effect, it's a worthy effect. But it's an absolutely false trail and blind alley to consider that unmanageability is a sine qua non, the bottom line, if you will, of first step. It's not. And therefore, when we concentrate all of our efforts in answering 495 questions about unmanageability, we miss the whole point. The point is that the first step of Alcoholics Anonymous is a gift. And that gift is given to us by a higher power, by God. Just as the second step is a gift and the third step is a gift. We can't force these things on ourselves. What we do is we do the work. We get to meetings. We immerse ourselves in the program and in people in recovery. We read the book and we begin to pray. And when we do that, what happens? We will learn that we have to fully concede to our innermost selves that we're alcoholic. This is the first step in recovery, and it just comes. If you haven't tried that, try it. You'll find it works. It never fails. But now there is a second part to the first step, which is part and parcel with the first part, and needs to be, of course, because it really relates to the same syndrome. That is to say that we are alcoholics, but what does it mean to be an alcoholic? First, let's start out with the basics, shall we? If I am an alcoholic, it means that I am afflicted with a disease which is incurable, invariably fatal, and progressive, and that I am powerless over that disease, that I am powerless over the obsession and compulsion to drink alcohol. If I do not stop drinking, I am going to die, because the disease is invariably fatal. It's a straight line equation. There's no mystery there. Furthermore, being a real alcoholic, being a chronic alcoholic, means that I have a body which does not accept alcohol as a normal person's body does. That when I drink alcohol, it sets up a physical phenomenon of craving over which I have no power and no control. Now once I start drinking, I can't stop. But I have to stop drinking or I'll die. I have to be free of the concession of the obsession to drink and the compulsion to drink, because I can't get rid of my body. See? We're stuck with that. But we have to be free of the obsession and compulsion. Now then, if I drink at all, the phenomenon of craving kicks in, doesn't it? That's the definition of an alcoholic, which means that once I start, I can't stop. Which means then, as Dr. Silkworth told us back in his opinion, that for the real alcoholic, this is a person who can never safely drink alcohol again for the rest of his or her life. That's the truth of it. Now then, didn't we just read that the persistence of the illusion that we'll someday be able to drink normally is the great obsession of every abnormal drinker? That many pursue this into the gates of insanity or death? True, and that's exactly what happens. So let's read this next sentence. The delusion that we are like other people or presently may be has to be smashed. So you can see the full parameters of the first step. It is not only the concession to our innermost selves that we're alcoholic and everything that entails, but coupled with that is that the smashing of this delusion that we are, or presently may be, like other people. In other words, here's the way it comes down. It's so simple, really. In order to take the first step, it is necessary that we accept as a fact that we can never safely drink alcohol again the rest of our lives. In other words, when we take the first step, we take it without reservations of any kind. Now that's tough for some folks, and many don't make it. And many people are wandering around AA, in and out, trying to work the steps, trying to get sober, can't figure out what the heck's going on with them, why doesn't it work for them? And when they took their first step, they reserved to themselves at least the possibility that somewhere down the line they'll be able to drink again. Because that reservation will absolutely wipe out any attempt from there on to work the rest of the steps. Everything from there on is going to be done with reservations. But somewhere down here I'll be able to jump off the train. Somewhere down here I'll be able to say bye-bye to you guys and go back doing the stuff that I want to do, which is to be able to drink like a normal person. So without any reservations at all, we must accept as an absolute fact that we can never safely drink alcohol again in any form. Now people say, but wait a second, the big book says we haven't sworn off. That's not what this is saying. It doesn't say we're swearing off. It says we're recognizing and accepting as a fact that we can never safely drink alcohol again. The plug is in the jug. We are not able, nor should we attempt, to swear off. That's not necessary. Knowing that the plug is in the jug, now what are we going to do? We're going to look to the solution. We're going to switch gears here altogether. Because the solution to our problem with alcohol, to our alcoholism, and yea, verily, to our drug addiction, if that happens to be our problem, it's all the same solution from here on out. We're dealing with symptoms of a spiritual disease. And therefore, the answer to all of our problems is a spiritual answer. And the alcohol and anything else, overeating, the gambling, whatever it is, are symptoms of this disease. Now, it's true that the real alcoholic is the only one carrying around some kind of a problem in their bodies, which they never lose. But we know, too, that the spiritual disease being overcome straightens us out mentally and physically, and that applies to every single human being. And so the answer, and this is so important, I want to make sure we get this straight. The answer to alcoholism is not to swear off. The answer to the disease is not to deny ourselves the alcohol, or to deny ourselves the right to live in a normal life, or to be around people who drink, or any of those things. That's not the answer at all. That may postpone the inevitable down the road. The answer is a spiritual answer. The program is a spiritual program, and the 12 steps are spiritual principles. So the answer is that we go from a place of rebellion and defiance over here that we came in the door, and we go over here to a place of surrender and obedience to a higher power. And it is then that we have our spiritual awakening. It is then that we find that the problem has been removed, not by us, not by counselors, not by drugs, not by anything except the power of a higher power, the power of God. We will find that when we get to the 10th step, the big book tells us the truth, that the obsession and compulsion to drink alcohol has been removed. It is gone. It does not exist for us. The problem has been solved. We'll not be interested in liquor anymore. And we haven't even sworn off. So first then, if we get this concept, now we can begin to understand what's going on here. If we first are able to get that first step with no reservations, that we are in fact alcoholics, no doubt about it, and we can never safely drink alcohol again, and there's no reservations about that. We're not sitting back waiting for the time when we can slip out and start drinking again. Then we're going to turn our thoughts to a whole new way of life, a spiritual way of life, which is characterized by the remaining 11 steps. The first of which, of course, is the second step, which teaches us that God has the power. God exists and has the power to restore us to sanity. Recognizing that we have much, much, much we must do to reach that point. I do not like, I don't enjoy in any sense stepping on anybody's program. And I'm certainly not being critical of anybody here. I try not to be. But I can't help what the big book says. And when we're doing this book together, we're going to go by what it says, because it's what we have. And because it has worked for millions of people before us. And when we follow this big book and we accept it as truth and we follow the directions in this book, we recover. What more do we need to know? It works. Let's go on page 30 now. We alcoholics are men and women who have lost the ability to control our drinking. We know that no real alcoholic ever recovers control. This is all real basic stuff, isn't it? All of us felt at times that we were regaining control, but such intervals, usually brief, were inevitably followed by still less control, which led in time to pitiful and incomprehensible demoralization. We are convinced to a man that alcoholics of our type are in the grip of a progressive illness. Over any considerable period, we get worse, never better. Now, you would say, this would be a good time for the big book to describe the progressiveness of the disease of alcoholism. But no, it's going to make us wait a while. I know quite a few of you have studied the book intensively, and you know where the description of the progression of the disease of alcoholism is found in the book. But I'm going to show you anyway. Turn to page 108. Now then, this is a chapter to wives. What's this stuff doing in this chapter? Well, whoever said that this book was supposed to be written so that it could be outlined for a college exam? Bill wrote it as he was inspired to write it. When he got to the chapter writing to the wives to tell them about their husbands, he figured it's about time to explain to them what this progression really was. So down at the bottom of page 108, you will find husband number one. That's the heavy drinker. On page 109, you find husband number two, showing lack of control. Bottom of page 109, husband number three, gone much further than number two. And then finally, on page 110, you find husband number four, you know, behind the dumpster guy. So in these three pages, we find the description of the progression of the disease of alcohol. And then it goes on for another six pages, continuing to further and further describe this phenomena of progression, which is one of the hallmarks of the disease of alcoholism. So think again when you want to argue with your sponsor about reading the whole book. I bet you that in most of the books that are sitting around here that are privately owned, if there's a $100 bill belonging to the owner, it's been stuck here in the chapter to wives, and they probably forgot where they put it. And it may never be found again. Or, of course, a better hiding place is probably in the chapter to employers. So few of us have ever experienced that high and noble aspiration. Because everything in this book ties in with everything else. As a matter of fact, in the chapter to wives, we're going to find a little later when we're looking at the four step, we're going to find some of the most important language of all dealing with the remedy, the spiritual solution to our resentments. It's right there in that chapter to wives. And so going back now to page 30, over any considerable period we get worse, never better. We are like men who have lost their legs, they never grow new ones. Neither does there appear to be any kind of treatment which will make alcoholics of our kind like other men. We've tried every imaginable remedy. In some instances, there has been brief recovery, followed always by a still worse relapse. And so many of us have experienced this, you know. Physicians are familiar with alcoholism and agree there's no such thing as making a normal drinker out of an alcoholic. Science may one day accomplish this, but it hasn't done so yet. I was just thinking the other day, what happened to that ballyhooed program at Miami University Hospital that they came out with it about 3 or 4 years ago? How they were going to make, remember that, Billy, they were going to make normal drinkers out of alcoholics? One of these days, I mean, that was on the front page, was a headline. One of these days, if you look very carefully in section 3, down in the bottom corner of page 14, with about one or two inches, you'll find a very tiny little story that says, University of Miami decided that didn't work out too well. I remember when the almighty Rand Institute in Santa Monica, California, came out with something that the New York or the Los Angeles Times had banner headline. The Rand Institute has found a method to make normal drinkers out of alcoholics.
Science.
And so many people flocked to that, because this is a, I mean, this is a powerful think tank, you know. I mean, this is a big time guys. And so many people crashed because of it, and they finally had to give it up after about 3 years. They had to admit it didn't work. Go to the churches and ask any minister, ask any priest or monsignor, ask any rabbi or other spiritual leader, how are you doing in getting the drunks and addicts in the midst of your congregation, getting them clean and sober? And if they're being honest with you, you're going to have to tell you, boy, it's frustrating. We have brief remissions here and there, but there's always a worse explosion than ever, and they're mystifying. Go to any doctor. I was talking to my doctor today, and he knows I've been around here for a long time. He keeps asking me these really stupid questions, and I tell him they're stupid. I say, Doc, you better learn about this stuff. He's a general practitioner, or what do you call him,
family guy.
He's supposed to know about this stuff. The ignorance out there is astonishing, even today. What's the matter? You seem like you're normal in every other respect. Why did you drink too much? You know, holy cow, Doc. You've got great willpower. Why didn't you use it? What do you mean you have to go to a higher power for help? Just stop drinking so much. Then he says to me, you know, I don't drink. I said, how come? He says, it puts me to sleep. And I said to him, Doctor, count your blessings, son. I'll bet you this guy would be an alcoholic like, what a ring-tailed raccoon if he ever really tied into a bunch of booze. He's a candidate for sure. He just doesn't know it. In any event, it is. Here's the truth of it, guys. And you know, I used to think that maybe this was an overstatement. There had to be something out there that would work besides AA. Or what Dr. Silkworth talked about, or what Dr. Young talked about, you know, this once in a blue moon spontaneous change, this psychic change that they see happening every once in a while to people without apparently any help from God. I suspect God's sitting back there just doing his thing, but other than that, the human solutionists out there simply do not have the answer. And it must be horribly frustrating. Because you see, as we're going to learn as we go through this chapter, there are two things that don't work, clearly don't work. And one of these things is so dear to the hearts of the professionals. Self-knowledge. If you could just get to know yourself, if you could just get to know your inner feelings, if you could just come to the place where you understand that you're entitled to your feelings, if you can just learn to control your actions and don't get overboard with your feelings. If you just knew why you drank or knew why you drugged, you'd quit doing it. Coupled with, first we're going to teach you about yourself, and then we're going to scare you to death about being yourself. Because look what's going to happen to you if you drink. Look at this. See all these results. Look at all this chemical stuff going on over here and what happens to your brain. And you know, they chop off a leg and to keep it you from feeling the phantom foot, they're going to fill your leg full of vodka. That's one of the things I used to hear coming out of the treatment center. You take the vodka and you eject it into the stump because it kills off all the nerve endings and you stop feeling the phantom foot. I don't know whether that's true or not. But it seemed to be the answer to the question, what does alcohol do to us? Well, it supposedly kills off all kinds, like millions of nerve cells and stuff, which never regenerate and that sort of thing. I don't know, that's probably true. But if you knew that, and you had, and you were sitting there feeling down and low and lonely, and somebody put a big drink in front of you, would you stop and think about all the little nerve cells that are going to get killed? I seriously doubt it. You'd say, oh, what the hell? Oh, man, that's good. When somebody sticks a drink in front of you and you're down and you're lonely and you're feeling blue, or there's a good-looking guy or good-looking gal and you'd like to go talk to them and you're scared to do it, somebody puts a drink down in front of you, are you going to stop and think, she's a trigger? He's a trigger. Well, he looks like a trigger, like the horse, you know. Gene Autry's horse.
Roy Rogers' horse.
The Lone Ranger's horse is silver, right? And what was the name of Tonto's horse? Remember? Scout. What's the matter, you people? Don't know? You don't remember the Lone Ranger? Remember this one? Hey, Tonto. Indians in front of us. Indians behind us. Indians to the left of us. Indians to the right of us. Tonto, we're in deep trouble now. Old friend, speak for yourself, Kemosabe. Oh, hi, old silver away. I'll never forget the night I woke up. I was a kid. I was sleeping out in the dining room on a day bed, and there was poinsettias outside the window, and it was moonlight, and there those poinsettia leaves were going like this in front of the window, and I'd just been listening to Little Orphan Annie, and she's being chased by the Wolfman, and I swear those were the Wolfman's ears, and I was screaming bloody murder. Oh well, I don't know, we probably better stop here, I guess. I hate to do it. I mean, if you guys want to keep going, we can go on for another hour or so, but no, okay, all right. I hear some grumbling starting. Yeah, I guess you got it figured out. I'm pretty passionate about this book, and I love it, and I love this group. I'm so happy to be able to do this with you, and I hope you're enjoying it too. Thanks very much. Come on up, son.
Would somebody like to do the chips? Volunteer to do the chips?
Come on, who's the chipmunk tonight?
Okay, here we go. We got one.
Chipmeister.
Hi, I'm Suzanne, alcoholic, a little one, member of Amish Western Big Book Workshop. We have a chip system here in South Florida, because you are gambling with your life, but you don't have to do it no more. Here's a white chip. It's for now, right now, today. It's a surrender. It's a surrender to win. And then we have a 24-hour chip, 30-day chip. It says 24 hours on it, but it's a 30-day chip. Congratulations. Do we have any more 30-dayers? Okay. How about 90 days? A red chip. No? Keep coming back. Then you'll get one. 6 months. Blue chip. Nope. Keep coming back. You'll get it. You'll get it. 9 months. Does anyone need a 9-month chip? Keep coming back. It's getting closer. You'll get it pretty soon. And that's it. How about, is anybody celebrating today or this month? 1 year. 1 year, yay! No? Right, in some time, right in front of me. All right. Another one back here in blue? Just John? That's okay. You can do that too. Did I miss anybody? No? Okay, just in case. If anybody wants to see me after the meeting, if anybody's got a thinking problem, my home group hands these out. It's got the negative word and the positive word. And if you think that's awesome, it's got the St. Francis prayer on the back. So see me after the meeting in case you have a thinking problem.
Okay, anonymity, let's close. Anonymity is our spiritual foundation. What you hear here, leave it here.
A moment of silence, please, for the alcoholics that are still suffering in the other rooms and their families, followed by the Lord's Prayer. Our Father. Amen.